What's going on, guys? Welcome back to another interview edition of Learn Crypto. My name is Nick Hellman, and today I have with me Chris, the project lead of Nirvana, your key to financial enlightenment. How are you doing today, Chris?
Doing all right, Nick. Thanks for having me. How are you?
Pretty good. Not too bad. New Year's here. Hopefully 2021 is a little better than 2020. I know you're probably a little tired. I'm a little tired, but never a bad time to look at new projects. Right. I think you guys are brand new. Only, what, a week old now, or...?
Yeah, right around a week. I think this is actually day six, if I'm not mistaken.
So we're really early on this, guys. So I'm going to try to get Chris to give us the information on this project, and hopefully you guys can continue to do your own research, follow along, and see if it's something that fits your portfolio guidelines or your utility guidelines for the DeFi space. So I guess let's jump right into this. Can you give us a brief overview of Nirvana and the native cryptocurrency, which is the Vana token?
Yeah, absolutely. So Nirvana is an autonomous liquidity generating protocol. So basically, there's a 6% fee on all transactions, and 3% of that fee is distributed to all of the Vana holders proportional to their holdings. And then the other 3% is locked in permanently locked liquidity. So the with every buy and every sell, our holders' wallets grow in their Vana size, and our liquidity also grows.
That's interesting. And how did the Nirvana or the Vana token come about? Did you guys use source code from a different project? Did you guys build this from the ground up, or how did that really come to creation?
Right. So actually, it's a pretty awesome origin story. So basically what happened was there was a group of about 19 of us who all decided, hey, like, you know, we kind of want to launch a token, and like, we are just sick of needing to like rely on other teams to kind of get things done, because to be honest with you, in my experience in DeFi, teams are always very delayed on everything they promise to deliver. Hype dies very quickly for these tokens, and then all of a sudden you're holding the bags of everyone else who exited above you.
Or you have a rug pull situation, outright right. scam. So right. which we're trying to protect from as well. So that's why it's nice to get on here and talk to you and see what you're all about.
Absolutely, of course. And so we pretty much just took the initiative. The 19 of us provided one ETH of liquidity each to kind of get it going. And then we launched without making any hype announcements, anything like that. So it was basically a stealth launch, but like with 19 of us knowing that it was going to happen. And then we, as a team, did one big buy of the token after it was launched. And then so we split that between 19 of us, and it worked out so that we basically got the token at a price of 10 cents per Vana. So it was already about 10 times from the listing price. So the point of all of that really was so that our team, like our quote team allocation, I guess, didn't give us like this crazy amount of supply, didn't give us a crazy advantage to any of the retail buyers on the market. We just kind of wanted to have this token launch, have something that we could help shape and build. But without, you know, any of the normal concerns that go along with these kind of stealth launches, which can be pretty shady if people are less upfront about how things are operated.
Right. And so is the total supply of Vana currently in circulation? Is there more team funds you're holding back? Is there more to be sold via OTC? I mean,
everything,
how is that?
Everything is in circulation. It's already fully diluted. And there were no team tokens. All of the marketing has come straight out of our pockets. So there's been like no selling of Vana tokens to help pay for marketing. It's just been that we had extra ETH before this. And so that's kind of how we've been paying for everything so far. It's just basically we believe in a project that we're building. And so we're willing to throw in money at it until it gets to where it should be.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty unique that everything's already circulating. So you guys don't have to worry about downward pressure. The staking rewards come from people buying or selling with that fee that you put on top of it. We've seen this with other projects in the past. Some have had a lot of success. Some have had some minor failures due to the token not really having any utility. Now, I have looked into Vana a little bit, so we'll get to that shortly. And I think you guys do have some utility plan for Vana to keep people holding, to keep people buying, accumulating, and using the token moving forward. But before we move on, has there ever been an audit on the current smart contracts? So this algorithm that you're talking about, every time you buy or you sell, there's a 6% fee. Half of it goes to the liquidity on Uniswap, which is awesome because a lot of these DeFi projects, we're always worried about low liquidity. So if you ever want to or have to sell, whether it's a rug pull, whether there's just not much liquidity there, you're going to have huge slippage or get caught with a bag. So that is great to increase liquidity there. But then the other 3% gets from the seller or the buyer to the already existing holders. So it kind of incentivizes people to keep holding Vana in their MetaMask wallet to earn those quote-unquote staking rewards. So that's awesome, but has the actual code ever been audited? Do you plan on getting it audited? Or what can you say here to kind of give users and investors peace of mind that that's going to continue to work properly?
So we are basically an exact replica of another token. It's not exact, but it's very similar. And that token's code has been audited by Warren Ruggles on Twitter, which really at this point is one of the only audits that like really matter, because Warren Ruggles is like, you know, the guy who will go out and say, this is a scam, you need to stay away. And to that extent, like, that's where a lot of the big unaudited concerns come from, since he already pretty much gave his stamp of approval on the project off which we based our code. We're pretty much in the clear in that realm. With that said, like, as soon as we have more funds that are actually belong to our team and not just coming out of our wallets, like, we are more than happy to pay for auditors and everything else. But all the developers we work with as well have established tokens and established communities and people who they just can't afford, basically, right, to design a contract that would do anything other than what we designed to do.
Right. It seems like so far the Vaults token, or the token that you kind of forked from, if that's what you want to call it, hasn't had any flaws in that smart contract. And I know you guys are young, 6 days, 7 days, but so far we've done some tests, me and some other people, and it appears that the 3% is in fact going to liquidity. You guys can easily see that on Uniswap. I'll provide the contract below, but the liquidity is going up every day, not by people wanting to be an LP, but by transactions occurring on the blockchain, it appears. And then also holders seem to be receiving the proper allocation of Vana tokens for each transaction that is occurring. So for my preliminary research and kind of looking at Etherscan, it does look like that contract is working like you guys are presenting it, which is good. So far, so good. The next question is, for the 3% rewards that go to holders, is that based off time that they're holding it, or is it just proportion on the amount of Vana tokens that they hold, or is it a mixture of both?
So it's purely just tied to the amount of Vana that they hold. There's no time amount that helps you accumulate more or anything like that. Everyone, whether you buy tomorrow or you bought on the first day, you have the same access to the Vana rewards that everyone else does.
Right. I kind of like that too, because not everybody finds every project at the same time. This gives everybody a fair chance at those rewards based on their investment amount into this asset. So some people like the time because it shows, oh, the OGs get better payouts. But for me, since there's 19 of you that knew that there was going to be a stealth launch, that would actually be more unfair to new users in the community, because obviously you guys would be in day one and then always be one step ahead in terms of the amount of rewards that you receive. So I like that you guys did just based on holdings. So if a whale wants to come in today, tomorrow, the next day, they're on equal playing field with everybody else who's been around since day one. So I like that.
Right. And it just kind of goes along with the way we wanted to run all of this. Like, we didn't want the team to be like this like big ominous force that controls like the supplier has a better advantage over anybody else. We wanted to just create a token and an ecosystem that we're probably about to get into, where everyone like can just participate without fear of, you know, venture capitalists like dumping on them without any really true whales or anything like that. I think that like our biggest holder has like 4% or 5% of the supply or something like that. So there's no one who's like a disproportionate big monster holder of Vana. And I think that's something that makes us very strong.
Right. Yeah. Cause sometimes you get those big whales. It can be good if they're just going to set it and forget it, but it can be bad if they want to start manipulating the direction of a project and everybody's kind of in fear of them dumping. So they kind of go along with their ideas, whether they're good or bad. Right. The last question before we kind of get into the ecosystem, you know, is there ever going to be, right now there's not a tool or a dashboard or an estimated calculator to let prospective users, investors, speculators kind of get an idea of what they're earning per day, what they did earn, what they're going to earn. Do you guys have any ideas to create something like that? Just kind of a nice user-friendly overview so people can kind of see their Vana accumulating or what's going on with their wallet balances?
No, absolutely. We definitely do have plans for that. So I was very, very early into Reflect RFI. And I remember the day that that dashboard came out for them, and it was just awesome. Like, it was super cool to finally see exactly how well everything was working. And yeah, we've already spoken briefly to a developer for it. It's just a matter of, we need to have team funds to do anything. And but like, honestly, I'm running out of money. So I need to raise some before I can do any cool stuff like that. But that's definitely on a top priority for us.
RFI did really well. So I think you got some money.
I was there for launch of RFI, and that's pretty much how I got here. So
that's awesome. So, I mean, the question people are probably asking is, okay, you said there is no team funds, there's no team tokens. How are you going to raise money? What do you mean? You keep saying you need money to do more. And I think that kind of gets into my next question. You know, what are some of the benefits of holding Vana? And I think I came across something to do with pre-sale access. You know, we're kind of seeing some launch pools have a lot of success. You know, what do you guys have planned for holders of Vana simply besides staking? And maybe that's going to kind of get into how you plan on getting some revenue to continue to build this project up.
No, absolutely. Like I said before, like, I think that probably the main issue with all of these tokens in DeFi right now isn't the fact that they aren't good tokens or good protocols. Like, they all have genius ideas behind them, but that's just all that they have. They just have these great ideas for these tokens. And then the team is kind of like, all right, well, go ahead and ride these tokenomics forever. And hopefully it works out for you. And that's pretty much just not how we're going to do things. We're going to keep building off of this very good central token that we already have, because it's like the nature of like the ever growing liquidity and everything, it's a great starting place, because you'll never like run out of liquidity on the Vana side of things. So what we plan to do, both in terms of raising money and in terms of kind of maintaining demand and, the relevance of Vana, is just to continually release tokens that relate and work with Vana that kind of integrate some of the other areas of success that DeFi has had. So, for example, our first pre-sale, which starts today, is for Bliss. And Bliss is going to be a token which you can pair with Vana. And you pair with Vana and you stake it on our website to farm WBTC, so wrapped Bitcoin. And we are one of the only movers on this area. Getting access to Bitcoin without actually having to purchase it is a pretty rare endeavor. And we're pretty happy with the way all of the tokenomics and everything are working out with it. And that's pretty much how we're going to raise money to continue building after Bliss. We're pretty much funding everything that we're doing right now, again, out of our pockets. And then the Bliss pre-sale will kind of be like a catalyst for us to continue with the marketing, continue with, you know, project development, and, just to continue building everything out, basically.
And is there a reason that people, or do people need to hold Vana in order to even participate in the Bliss pre-sale, or is there any perk to that, or is there going to be a perk of to Vana holders in the future for other pre-sales? Because I'm looking at your roadmap and it looks like you got a Bliss pre-sale, which you said is happening today at some point, but then you have a list of other pre-sales and announcements and partnerships that are all going to kind of occur in January and February of 2021.
Right. So there definitely is an advantage to holding Vana for these pre-sales. If you hold 500 or more Vana, you participate in pre-sale one, round one, basically. And that will be 15% cheaper than the second pre-sale, which will be open to the public. And so that's going to be the case with all of the pre-sales that we do. And all is going to be that if you hold at least 500 Vana, then you will always get a place in the earlier pre-sale, which will always be cheaper than the second one. And beyond that, you know, just for the tokens themselves that are being built while Bliss is traded on ETH, several of the tokens that we'll release in the future will be paired with Vana instead of ETH. And so that will automatically mandate that if any of those projects survive, even for, you know, a few months, a year, whatever, that's unending, unyielding volume that Vana can just survive off of forever.
Right. And more volume equals more rewards for holders.
Right. More rewards for holders, more liquidity, everything. And so it's pretty much just going to be an engine where each token that we release builds off of the previous tokens that already exist. So another example is like the following token that we're going to release, will incentivize providing liquidity for Bliss and ETH so that our WBTC farming system will be more sustainable and you know, can continue to survive in a way that is extremely beneficial to our holders.
And how is the WBTC farming going to work for Bliss? Is that going to be like a Bliss Vana pair that then produces Wrapped BTC, or what's the idea there?
So it's technically complicated the way that it's kind of accomplished, you know, just because obviously Bliss and Vana shouldn't get you WBTC because obviously there's no transactions that result in WBTC or whatever. But basically, yeah, it's going to be that you pair Vana and Bliss in an LP pairing, even though that's not the native trading pair. And then it's really just for the purpose of removing both of them from circulation and staking them on our website. So you stake that LP on our website, and then 5% of all Bliss transactions are taxed, basically. And then that 5% will be converted into WBTC, and then on a weekly basis, and then that WBTC will be distributed to all the LP stakers.
So it kind of has that same transactional fee that Vana has, but instead of going to holders and liquidity, you're using a percentage of that to buy Bitcoin, Wrapped Bitcoin, to then distribute to Bliss and Vana LPs. So I was wondering how you're going to get Bitcoin to pay people out. That makes a lot of sense. You have the same code in place, but instead of passing that on to Bliss and Vana holders, you're going to buy Bitcoin and then pass that Bitcoin on. People would ask, why would you do that? In my mind, that's a good marketing tool. Everybody wants Bitcoin. So now they have a chance to earn Wrapped Bitcoin passively. But then also B, that removes selling pressure on Bliss and Vana because people aren't getting rewarded in those native coins. They're getting rewarded in Bitcoin. So for some reason people want to sell, they'll be selling Bitcoin rather than Bliss or Vana. So I think that's pretty interesting.
No, absolutely. And look, like we all know what happens to our favorite Uniswap, you know, coins when Bitcoin pumps, right? They all get demolished. And like all of these like beautiful market structures that we had get just destroyed. So this is really just meant to act as sort of a hedge on what Bitcoin does when it pumps, or what Bitcoin does to our investments when it pumps, is that like you're still getting the exposure to Bitcoin that you could be getting without having to actually spend money on it and without having to leave, you know, the Uniswap game that we all play.
Right. Exciting times. I mean, that's really about all the questions I had. I also did notice that I think a portion of the Bliss presale is going to be used for buybacks of Vana. Do you know which percentage you guys are discussing? Is this going to be a governance or community decision? And then when or how do you plan on doing that buyback of Vana after the first presale? Is this going to roll over to other presales? Could you just kind of give us some insight to that?
Yeah. So the Bliss presale is a hard cap of 115 ETH. I'm sorry, 300 ETH. If we hit that hard cap, we plan on using 115 ETH for Vana buybacks, not as one singular market buy, but as sustained buybacks of the token, so that it kind of gives us a more sustainable and long lasting pump. And so the idea of it is that we're really just recycling money back into the community, and we're bringing direct value to Vana holders, even though that this token isn't paired with Vana, as our future ones will be. So it works out to about 38% of the money raised will be used for Vana buybacks, and that will be something that we continue to do throughout all of our pre-sales. So the idea is that regardless of what any of these tokens function to do, there will always be some value brought back to Vana, which is going to kind of be the central core of the ecosystem, like from this point going forward.
Right, that's really interesting and helpful, because if there's any kind of dump or whatever, you can be there to kind of add some support to that and continue an upward trend. So if you guys do what you're saying you're going to do, the token economics from my brief overview plus this conversation looks really good. Looks well thought out. Looks like there's utility for Vana, plans to be more utility for Vana. I know a concern for people would be if you're actually going to have pre-sales or partners. But based on your roadmap, it looks like you have 3, 4, 5 of them already in the works for the first 2 months of 2021, which is great. And kind of see what happens.
Just one more thing on the governance stuff. Obviously, we're going to have a lot of Vana after we do all that. And so that's kind of where the community governance comes in, is what do you guys want us to do with all this Vana that we hold now? And even, you know, we're going to use some of it for the partnership stuff so we can help with people like open Vana pools and stuff like that. but I mean, very well, the community voted to like burn half of this massive stack of bond that we had to make it more deflationary, then go for it. Like it's going to be the community's money to do with what they please.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, and I think using it for LPs would be great too, because then you're not putting downward pressure on the market, but also you're kind of setting up your other pre-sale tokens for success. You have that ability to put funds into each of the LPs simply using the buybacks, which is pretty great, and then grows the Vana ecosystem as well. So I think, you know, I don't really see many negatives. The only negatives I can say is the team, including yourself right now, many of you are anonymous. If you want to kind of go in to why you guys are anonymous, that would be great. But as far as the code and the mechanisms all seem to be ran by smart contracts. And then, of course, there is the risk of, yes, guys, it is a brand new project. Yes, it's on Uniswap with ETH gas fees. But I think it'll be very telling on how this first Bliss presale goes to determine kind of the future and the direction of Vana moving forward. So for some of you guys who have less risk tolerance, maybe you want to set out the Bliss presale, see how things progress, see if that goes off without a hitch, wait till we see the buybacks coming, and then get more deeply involved. But again, I always leave that up to you guys, and we can look deeper. So, I mean, Chris, before we leave, if you want to get into the anonymity or any last words that you want to speak on.
I'm absolutely happy to explain why I have to be anonymous, and I think it's a pretty fair reason. So I'm in my last year of law school right now. And being a lawyer is something that I've wanted to do forever. And basically, as a law student, it would be a little bit, it could make the bar and fitness aspect of the bar exam, I'm sorry, the character and fitness aspect of the bar examination more complicated for me if I were to kind of be a public face on a cryptocurrency, just because I'm not breaking any rules by doing this, but just like, you know, people could go back into Telegram and everything and kind of just trace all of what I've been doing in terms of all of this. And it could potentially jeopardize my future as a lawyer. And so it'd just be easier for me to get into being a lawyer, get bar certified, and then come forward with my name and just be more of a public face of this. It just doesn't make sense for me to do it right now.
Right.
I'm so close to finishing this goal. So
that makes sense, because I know that is something that they look into when you're doing the bar and trying to become a lawyer. Also, there is a little bit of a gray area and muddy water right now with the SEC and cryptocurrencies anyways. So I've been fortunate enough that I can be public, but you know, I work for an institutional financial advisor for traditional assets. If they start or if they start getting more into crypto assets, then I'm sure I'm going to kind of be in that gray and muddy water area as well. Not for the YouTube channel. We have a Discord and a Patreon that we kind of give some non-financial advice on trends in the cryptocurrency market. So right now I'm in the clear, but I could see myself as well being trying to make decisions like you if my company started moving into Bitcoin and crypto assets. So
no, and look, I mean, I like plenty of people in my general circles know who I am. Like it's just a little bit difficult for me to go like fully public and out there with it, but I'm not like the extent to which I would have to risk doing any sort of scam would totally outweigh the benefits, just because my future as a lawyer would be gone. So like it just isn't my character to begin with.
Because somebody would dox you in the ecosystem. Right. I mean, right. Let's
like,
be honest.
Like, and like I don't use VPNs or anything like that. So like I'm not hard to find if people want to find me. So like I have nothing to hide other than my name, because I have to, basically.
Makes sense. All right. Well, that's really all the questions I had. We kind of went over everything. Is there any, you know, kind of ending elevator pitch for Nirvana and the Vana token? And has the snapshot already happened for the Bliss presale, or is it about to happen later?
It'll happen later today. So we're going to have to push back our presale. It's going to be directly after the Infinity Games AMA, but but our dev is on Pacific time, and so he just asked for some more time to push it back to this evening. So we're going to take it probably after the AMA for Infinity Games, just to also allow people from that group to kind of pop in if they want to.
Well, and that makes sense. I need to try to get this out to my community so people who are interested can get on board as well.
Right. And you know, just as a final elevator pitch, like pretty much everything that we're doing, if you can see from our logo and our first kind of our first token that's coming out, is that it's all kind of be kind of related to like Buddhist themes and everything like that. So it's going to be, we're basically basing all of the tokens in our ecosystem off of the 8 auspicious signs of Buddhism. And so in total, it'll end up being a 9 token ecosystem. And all of the themes will kind of tie into each other. And we think that it like the end goal being that our investors in our ecosystem get exposure to every area of crypto. So the first area that we're delving into is Bitcoin. The next token that we plan to release will probably give exposure to the kind of like a frictionless yield craze that has been DeFi recently. The one following will probably be DOT based. So like just that's kind of what the end goal here is to kind of give all of our investors a chance to be exposed to as many areas of crypto, so that say like DOT is having a big week, you know, our DOT token would be the token that probably people would be most excited about for that week. And so it's all kind of just supposed to be held kind of in-house and diversified so that it kind of never, the hype never dies, the token system never dies. And so that we're kind of just trying to establish something permanent in the DeFi world that kind of exposes you to everything else.
That's really interesting. And, you know, like kind of you're building your ecosystem around Vana and the centralized point and, you know, kind of like people or we recommend to build a portfolio diversification into some top assets, some micro cap flyers. And because you're going to have good days and good weeks of the Bitcoin side, the alt side, whatever it may be. And regardless of how the crypto tide is going, you're going to be having a good day in your portfolio and there's going to be moves for you to make. So that, right. That's interesting. I didn't even know that really was a thing. I appreciate you being on here. Everybody, if you want to learn more, head over to nirvanadefi.com. I will have some links in the description below. Smash the like button, smash the subscribe button. Get over to their Telegram to learn more. If it interests you, it's kind of short notice, but 500 Vana today gets you access to the presale round one of Bliss. And I'm sure if you like that, the other presales are going to have similar structures to where you need to have a baseline of Vana to participate in the earlier rounds. So make sure to watch this video quickly, get the information quickly, kind of make a preliminary decision. I think for the first decision, it's not too much for most people. I think it's sitting somewhere around $500. So nothing crazy to kind of jump into the ecosystem and start being a relevant community member. So that's about all we got. Until next time, guys, stay tuned for your daily updates on cryptocurrencies right here at Learn Crypto.